सद्गुरु महाराज की। With the immense blessings of our beloved Guru Maharaj, Maharanyam Sri Sri Muralidhara Swamiji, we are all exploring some very important facets for our day-to-day life under the topic of intelligent living. And today and tomorrow are coordinated by our God Satsang of Minneapolis. And all the thoughts which we are talking about has been either directly or indirectly derived from the various discussions our Swamiji has blessed to many of us during various points of times. Many of the articles he has penned in Madhura Murali, the English version of it is available online for everybody to read. And some of it are derived from his poems, from Madhura Geetam. And the beauty with the on a personal note, our satsang is, we have discussed almost everything on earth with our Swamiji. And the compassion of our Swamiji is, he has never failed to give us clarity about the most mundane to the most spiritual or the most divine. And so, when Swamiji talk to us, he has said many times that we should also learn and teach. How do we live intelligently? So that small little nudges we have in going in the right direction comes a long way in actually having a more fulfilling life, a life of both joy and success, which in the current scenario is important for our spiritual growth as well. And we, last week, a couple of sessions we had, we saw how important it is for us to use buddhi or intellect like a charioteer stirring or steering the ratham or the chariot in the right direction. The driver of the chariot is the one who actually ensures that the chariot goes in the right path. Buddhi does that job. Horses are like our sense organs, and the rope which binds the horses is like the mind. If buddhi does not hold it, it is as good as not being there, because the sense organs will take us for a ride literally. And so a buddhi needs to hold on to the ropes bound with the horses to make sure all the 5 horses or 10 of them go in the path which buddhi decides for the well-being of the one sitting behind. He is called jiva or the soul. Mind may want a lot of things and it keeps changing. Buddhi may want a lot of things on its own, I don't know. But the whole chariot is there, put in place for the well-being and for the purpose of the raja sitting inside, isn't it? So this entire journey of life is actually shaped in accordance to the requirement of the soul, the individual soul or jiva. The grandest goal obviously is freedom of the jiva from jivana, individual soul. Freedom of this individual soul from the clutches of all these miseries of this existence is the final goal. But then it's pretty far off. Even for us to train the horses properly, to control it properly, is a good practice even when we are ready for the grand goal of liberation, moksha, etc. Let it come when it comes. But it's always good to keep the chariot in good condition. So when you are ready to take the journey, maybe 10 years from now, 2 years from now, or maybe 2 hours from now, whenever, you are ready with a very able mechanism of this transportation, so that we can go speedily towards our goal. And our Swamiji always says, life is very precious. Life is like a lyric. It's like a song. And it has to be relished. It has to be sung nicely. It has to, we have to realize the preciousness of life. And our Swamiji says, life immediately means time now for us. When you say he's living now, He is now in a time where his body is functioning, everything is functioning. Life, knowledge, time. When we say life is precious, the time given to us as human beings is also precious. Many times I have heard him say that even if somebody is ready to trade $1 million for 1 year of my life, a person should always vote for that 1 year, because that's far more precious than even money. Even when I was working in corporates, they used to have this complete reversal of the paradigm of understanding time and money. When I started my career, the first few companies used to say, time is money. Be careful, plan it well. When I came to automotive industry, they said, money is time, you see. So even if you have to spend more, doesn't matter. Get it to the market in time. Otherwise, it's as good as lost. Time is the essence. Now, instead of the currency being money as something which you measure all our activities up to, the whole paradigm has changed now, isn't it, to time. Now, the underlying currency is time. Now, time is far more precious. So, they said money is time. You see, be careful about it. That's how important time is. And that is one aspect of life. And the second aspect of life, when we are doing the day-to-day things, is what we call energy. We may have time, but what if we don't have the energy? Suppose I come home. Many times we say, I work only 8 hours in the office. I'm home for the remaining 16 hours. But then where is the energy to be there, really be there, to be present there? You see, energy. Though there may be time, there has to be energy for us to use the time properly. So the second aspect of life after time, which is very important, and all our decisions should be taken in such a way that we don't waste that resource. Many times we take financial decisions. So when I said time is money versus money is time, when we take decisions, it should have a consequence analysis of, is it going to take precious time out of my or my beloved one's hands, you see? For example, I have seen many people, they find that suddenly a PS2 or some game DVD is half the rate. Instead of $53, you get it for $29. And then your decision is immediately based on money. So immediately you get that extra CD or DVD or whatever you call it. But then when our loved ones get addicted to it and spend more time in it and lose that far bigger resource than money called time, it would be already too late, isn't it? So when we take decisions, remember, it's not just financial. That all of us have been drilled in to take financially sound decisions. Please, we should also start train ourselves to take these three decisions about time, energy, and the third one, which I'm going to tell right now, is called attention. And these three are the precious resources we have called life. I can live without money. And even if I have $1 million and I have only one day to live, can I bargain that one day for all the wealth in this world? I can't. This is an irreplenishable, non-renewable, irreplaceable resource. Money is not like that, you see. And that is the reason why generally, when the mind is not allowed to be reined in, reins of the horses, if it's not reined in by the intellect, then mostly the mind will take an easy decision, you see, not the right decision. Easiest decision is search in the light. Search in the light. When there is semi-lit areas, I can't search properly. You all know this old story, which we relish as a story, but we have to apply also now. Many times there is a story referred to by a person who does all these paradoxical stuff. Let me name the person X, okay? Because there will be other implications if I name him. So call him X. Once that X was actually searching under streetlights. He jumped one streetlight, searched everywhere. Oh my God, ran to the next streetlight, searched everywhere, ran to the next streetlight. And his friend came and said, what is happening? What are you doing? He said, I'm searching for my house key. And why are you searching only under street lights? Did you drop it there? I said, I don't know where I dropped it. Otherwise, why should I search? But why are you searching only under the street lights? there is light only there only na. So that's why I'm searching there. Dirna urupuma. So here, mind won't allow us to strain a little bit to at least take a torch light to search in the bushes or in between two dark areas. And it will search on a street light. What do you think is the street light? Street nale market dana. So marketplace is filled with only one thought all the time. Artham, artham, artham. Which is all money, money, money. The word artham means money. Word artham also means meaning. You see this? Same with Tamil, porul abdina. It also means meaning. It also means artham. So Vedantically, all Indian languages are united. You see, two of the oldest languages. So here, the mind will immediately take an easy decision related to money. But remember, more important than money is time, energy, and attention. Whenever we make any choices, it is worthwhile to spend a little more time in deciding whether would I have a positive consequence of a time, energy, attention if I do it, or would I have a negative consequence of time, energy, attention if I do it, for me, for him, for whoever it is. And the most common thing I've seen with some of the people I stay with right now is struggling with you have Gen Z and now our next generation, I don't know, the child which is born yesterday, what the name you're going to give, I don't know, you have exhausted all the alphabets. You have to start from A again, I think. Or Z1, Z2, Z3, I don't know. Those children don't know a world without distractions. You see, they don't know a world without electronics. So right from putting them to sleep and making them eat, calming down. Nowadays, that's one food is one. There used to be something called pacifier. Earlier, pacifier inga. Ipo onnu or few inches poi inga eduthu pacifier. You see, how do you pacify a child? Put on a small film and some rhyme, etc., with a small device. You see, and now pacifier instead of walk has become now ankh. You see, it has moved now. So that's how you pacify a child. That's how you feed the child. So now the child is now growing with complete lack of attention. It is growing with, it's not attending to food. It is not attending to people around. The whole attention is now distraction. So it eats absently. It talks absently. Child is seeing something now and somebody says, see who has come. Radhe, radhe. அப்படி எடுத்து இல்லையா எதுக்கு சொல்றேன்னா சைல்ட் டென்ட் வென் இட் வாஸ் பார்ன் அதுவும் தான் எழுது இட் டின்ட் சே வாட்ஸ்அப் வாட்ஸ்அப் எழுது யூடியூப் யூடியூப் எழுது ஆல் சில்ட்ரன் டு திஸ் டே தேங்க்ஃபுல்லி இஸ் கிரைங் குவா குவா இன் சம்ஸ்கிருதம் குவா மீன்ஸ் வேர் வேர் இன்ஸ்டெட் ஆஃப் ஷோயிங் த ஹையஸ்ட் ட்ரூத் வேர் வேர்னா You see, so levity apart, time, energy, attention are our resources. So when you have to make a choice, first of all, we need to pause to make a choice. Otherwise, the mind, like a reined horse, but not controlled by a driver, would take its own decisions, you see, absently. And I believe it's a gift given to us. I don't need to understand physiology to tell you all this. Namake, when you see the loveliness of creation, 99%, that's a number I have, atmospheric number. I pulled it out of a very rarefied atmosphere. Or in plain English, I pulled it out of thin air. Okay. So that number, say 95%. Most of our activities which are routine are automated, isn't it? So if I have to drive from my home to the office, I just sit in the car and I can do anything I want to, and the car and me somehow comes to the right place without too much of attention. Is this right now? Is this left now? Nothing. It automatically goes. Whether you call muscle memory, sense organ memory, all these are names. But the fact is, it is automated. Many times I have got into trouble because of it. Once in Bangalore, I was supposed to go to a bus stand. And I was as such just in time, Japanese. So we were just starting in time. And while we were going, I was not very old to Bangalore, neither am I new to Bangalore. So once I was going there, I could see that this car was not going towards Shantinagar bus stand. It was going somewhere else. I was thinking maybe to save time that one who my host is trying to show. After 5 minutes, I asked, where are you going? Who what is? Huh? Where are you going? And then he said, oh my God. I said, what? He said, I'm going to my office, actually. I thought it was a Saturday today. And I thought you are driving to, you know, drop me in the bus stand. Oh, all that happened. But the moment I sat down, the familiar roles, automatically, I'm so sorry, Ramuji, I'll try. And then we took a roundabout and somehow, you know, we reached in time. Just in time length, somehow in time at the Vitala. And that's where we actually reached the bus stand. Mm? And I took the bus. You know, most of it is automated. You see, and it is there for a good purpose, because too much of attention on things which are routine, nature or Bhagavan thought, let me automate it. Or subroutine putter. You see, too much routine now, subroutine. You see, I hope you still remember the IT language of all that. And so there is an automatic decision making happening by the mind if we are not aware. So whenever we are doing something, the easiest guidelines, values. Values means that which we value. Na? Life, it's valuable. And what are the three things we need to really value is time, energy, and attention. Not only availability of it, stability of it, and direction of it. All the three are important. Na? Time is available. But is the time available? Am I stable to do something positive? And am I doing it in the right direction? Moonerkaliya. Amount, stability, and direction. So here, when we take decisions, first, we need awareness that a choice is being made. You see, many times we are not aware, na? Adhu dhaan awareness. That I am making a choice. And I am making a choice out of default because I have not put my attention on to this choice making yet. The mind makes the same choice which is it has made about a year back or 10 days back or what most of the people make. The conditioning, that's what it is, right? My personal conditioning of my own personal past or me being in tune with hoi polloi, all these people around me. And that is what is called conditioning. So the mind would automatically make a choice and it won't even register I made a choice. We do things absently. Huh? And Shukamuni uses a nice term saying, Padiyum Urangi Pogum. Padiyum Urangi Pogum means that 50% of the life is gone in sleep. He's not talking about the rejuvenating sleep. It means all our life, we are living half asleep. You see, or full awareness or with full consciousness, if I live, at least important decisions, then what happens is, I can certainly take this chariot in the right direction. For that, I need to understand the value of three things. First, I need to understand the value of life. Far bigger than money. Far bigger than name. Life is time, energy, and attention. You see? And generally, if we are not careful, mind will do the easy thing. The easy thing is shut the tears of the baby, show something to it. See, and we think only once, na, huh? And then comes the dinner time. Once more. And now the child learns two things. When it cries, I can get my way happen. And when it cries, that's a good idea for me to get distracted. You see. And now the first time maybe the child cried genuinely because it's not hungry, I don't know. You see. But from now on, it has been conditioned that whenever I need something or something, distraction will work for me, you see. And I guess that's not a very happy place to go. And that is the reason why before we decide to do something for ourselves or for our loved ones, let us ask ourselves, what is the consequence of this small act I'm doing? Consequence on only three dimensions to start with. Financially, keep it aside. That we are anyway very frugal or maybe very clear about it. Time, energy, attention. Is it going to enhance all the three or at least one of the three or at least does it not adversely affect one of these three consequences, once you start thinking and doing, life would be a far good sounding lyric. சில பேர் இந்த ரைமிங் வேர்ட்ஸ் எல்லாம் எண்டில் போட்டுட்டு மிச்சதெல்லாம் ஃபீல் பண்ணிடுவாங்க. சன் இஸ் ஷைனிங் அண்ட் கிராஸ் இஸ் க்ரோயிங், இந்த மாதிரி ஆயிடக்கூடாது நம்ம லைஃப். யூ சி, அண்ட் தட் இஸ் த ரீசன் வை ஃபர்ஸ்ட் வி நோ தட் பகவான் ஹஸ் கிவன் அஸ் புத்தி, அண்ட் புத்தி இஸ் த இன்டலெக்ட், இட் இஸ் த கேப்பபிலிட்டி அண்ட் இட் இஸ் த அபிலிட்டி ஃபார் அஸ் டு சூஸ் பர்பஸ்ஃபுல்லி. You see, with purpose, and for that we need to be clear about the purpose, and we need to be understanding what are the three important valuable things for us, which is time, energy and attention, and that's why we need intellect to be synchronized with the mind. Now let us go to attention. This is very important. Lot of wonderful books have come on attention, and there are some very good books on how we are getting more and more into a age where two things are seriously affecting us. The first thing which is affecting us is society. People have become more and more manipulative. Do you agree or not? Second, society and people have become more and more distracting. We're into danger for attention. When people try to manipulate, you don't put your energy in the attention in the right direction. When people try to distract, when I say people, I mean lokam. No, it doesn't mean people. Huh? When I'm distracted and manipulated, I can't think sanely. Everything around me seems to be designed around that. You see, whether even early days, let me start with news. Early days, there were some printing media. They used to give me news. And when if it is there in newspaper, it was almost like it got to be true, you see. Because I guess the ethics were like that and the purpose was like that. And they also enjoyed independence and all that. But now you know, I know, whichever country we go, right from reporting of news to all these media, everybody has at least one axe to grind, if you get what I'm saying. And so our society has become very manipulative, which we have to accept. I think I see it very clearly, because this triumphantly this economics and psychology are mingling now. There are a lot of studies where human psychology of spending and understanding value of goods have married economics, which is a fantastic synergy, you see. But then it also has its flip side, because they don't know how to catch your attention the way they want it to be, you see. And they know how to play and mess with our decision-making process to give them the maximum leverage. And I've heard some stories, I don't know, there is nothing to hope. I think it's true. Whenever you go to an upstate or rather the higher end shopping, people play a variety of music. They have a variety of lighting, you see. All that they have researched and found, if they do that, you would tend to spend more there, more than what you really wanted to spend. And then the financial system is saying, spend now. We'll see about it tomorrow. Aldhana Ipapendra, consumerist. I'm not going to take any political stand here. I'm just telling you as an individual that the ambience around me is very manipulative. I realize it very well, right from pricing. Earlier days, the only manipulation they used to do is increase 10% and reduce 20%, other way around. They increase 20% and say, now 10% off, take it. And hey, it's rebate, we used to buy. But now, right from where you place it, right from what is priced next to this, above it, below it, they have thought through, you see? And that is how the society is. They are playing us. You know, they are a conspiracy theory based on it. It's also a minor thing, in a matter of few dollars, not a big deal. But I'm just telling you, this is how the world is going. And I see it is being manipulative, maybe harmlessly right now. And second thing is very distracting. You see, for example, I have this iPad. That's where I write my notes just to make sure I don't digress much. And while I am seeing the iPad, I get notifications, you see, saying that, you know, you have a call here, you have this, you have that, and there is an excellent offer for you, air tickets, 2023K. All that is coming now. So there is too much interruption to my focus. There is too much manipulation in my capability to decide sanely for my good. You believe or not? I hope you do. And then the research says, you know, one of our friends showed me this research activity, saying brain is not built for multitasking, it seems. Which is what our Vedanta also says. Mind can hold only one thought at a time. It is so obvious. That's why we refer to ourselves as first person singular. Na? If it becomes plural, adukku thani department, you see. Whatever name they give for that. You see, there is a separate department and you think you have multiple identities. Na? And they have that. So we never say, we came yesterday. Abdina, it is more a culture thing. It's, we don't mean it. We don't mean it. So here, our mind can hold on to only one thought at a time. Hence the brain, mind the brain, other than psychology, physiology. Brain can focus only on one activity at a time, which is pretty logical, and my own experience also. So when we say, I'm very good in multitasking, you see, I can in the same time see YouTube, talk to my friend in India, grate carrots, take care of the frying there, and also direct somebody outside how to garden. Idellam panna mudiyum sila perala, you see. But then for most of the others, it's not possible. Na? Another interesting research is, if we have an interruption of about 5 seconds in any activity we do, the chances of error becomes 3 times, it seems, because there is an interruption. And I tried proving a point and I got really burnt my hands in one of these prayer meetings in India. So I was trying to show them that when you are singing a song and suddenly stop it and ask them to again sing, it takes quite a while for that person to again set and sing. So I asked one boy and said, can you sing a good song? And he sang a very horrible song. And people were all cheering. I couldn't understand the lyrics. And then people were all abashed. And he said, why are you so high? He's not singing a song, you see. And then I said, hey, why are you singing this song? Is that sir, enak theriyum appadina pa alavudu go, you see. But then when you are interrupted, the chance of errors are more. Interruption is a distraction. And then another interesting article is, if you can pay attention to a task for 1 hour, it is equivalent to spending 4 hours with a divided mind or a distracted mind. So that is the power of attention over time, you see. Focus. That is our important, that's also our important value for life. Na? So when we take a decision to get something or get rid of something, if it somehow impacts our capability of attention, it's a problem, isn't it? And it has been well established that most of the videos which we see, if we see it for a long time, this was a research paper by Montessori School Association. There's the advantage of going around saying that I'll speak anywhere you call me. So they also share some information, which is very enriching. They found out that when children, they see videos, most of the current videos are designed to change the background or the foreground or something every 8 seconds. So the mind is now building in circuitry or whatever you call it, where the neurons are firing together, where the attention span is what you habituate the mind to. Na? So when you see something to make it more gripping, scene changes every 8 seconds. And that's the reason why some of our youngsters, most of them are not, some of them are, they can't pay attention for more than 1 minute, 2 minutes, focused attention, sharp attention. They need the change now. You see, if you are not giving the change, and then come back then. You see, So they need nothing wrong with them. That's how distractive our ambiences. So we should know now where we are living. It was not the case. At best, when we were all young, that rules won't apply now. If I look out from the window, once a minute something will pass the road. That is the maximum distraction for me. And now, once in 8 seconds, just check, do it for me. Top videos, which generally younger generation likes. Watch it. Find out what changes. What is the interval of something changing? Something should change. Either background will change, foreground will change, color will change. There will be a cut, there will be a zoom, there will be a pan. Yeah, don't will happen. And for you, we tried that with Ramayanam also. So that your attention span will not be much challenged. But anyway, so that is what we are living. So attention is premium now. That's life now. Life now, na time, attention, energy. Now attention is at a premium. And then finally, energy. And how do we manage energy? And the amount of energy is important. Nowadays, we find the amount of energy is really there. And I know for people who are having children at home, they're saying at least in school, they were expending the energy. But here, they don't know where to expend their energy. So you have that problem. So you understand what I'm talking about. Believe it or not, people used to think about time management of executives as number one priority. For the past 2 years, because of the demand, I myself have done courses on energy management of people. You see, it's a big field now. It's a field of the present and future, where they understood time they can manage, but what about the energy, you see? And the energy has three aspects to it. The amount of energy, which means no tamasam, and having a little bit of an energy, internal energy, not this physical alone. And the stability of that energy, which means you can't suddenly say, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama. Hare Rama. Stability. You see, stable. Many people do that. Divina Uttal, they will come, Thayataka, Thayataka. Avala Dhan Pogandrum. 2 hours you are supposed to do Nama. Suddenly you come, you have a burst of energy and then sit down in the side. Our Swamiji doesn't like it. Then I realized that energy should be stable also. You should know how to channelize it in a stable way. And we should not be a Arambha Surana, where we start great, but then over time, And the third one is the direction of the energy. How do we channelize it in a direction which only Buddhi can do all these three? So mind will be filled with a bundle of energy, but the Buddhi has to do three things. It has to understand when the mind has that energy, when it does not have, and when it has, what are the activities I need to sign up to and do it properly. When it does not have, what is the pushback I have to do to make sure that I don't make mistakes? Because a mind without energy cannot also be attentive. And the second thing is stability of the energy. Ask yourself, am I somebody who just suddenly has this energy and I burn it and suddenly become very dull and sit down? So how do I stabilize my energy? And the third thing is, how do I direct my energy? And do I fritter it away? Do I burn it away? Or do I use it for the purpose for which I am here? You see, these three things. And generally, there is something called emotional energy. Then you have something called physical energy. You know that. And the third thing is obviously your capacity or the energy for you to take tough decisions, willpower. The moon energy. So three directions of the energy is quantity, stability, and also its direction. Also, you have emotional energy and you have intellectual capability, willpower, and there is also the physical energy aspect. We all take care of physical energy a little bit properly. But what about emotional energy? There is something called emotional dissonance. Heard about it, emotional dissonance, the technical term. We feel something inside, but you can't show it outside. You see, how much is the problem with this? You have something inside, you can't show it outside. It's called the emotional dissonance. Hey, when you take all these technical terms, difficult to understand, but I come from Delhi. When we were in the fourth year, there was a great singer who lost his son. His name was Vivek. Son's name was Vivek. He was also an engineering graduate. And he lost his son in an accident and stopped singing. But since we as an engineering college wanted his program, he came and sang. And there is a lovely song which he sang, which I don't know whether it's a film song or an album song, that shows what emotional dissonance is. Aragon song, like Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, Kannadam, Hindi, Urdu, lam, fantastic poetic language. Tum itna jo muskura rahe ho, kya gham hai jisko chupa rahe ho. Tum itna jo muskura rahe ho. What he says is, you are laughing so well outside. What is the grief which you are trying to suppress and hide within? Tum itna jo muskura rahe ho, kya gham hai jisko, emotional dissonance. आंखों में नमी हंसी लबों पर क्या हाल है क्या दिखा रहे हो क्या गम है जिसको छुपा रहे हो तुम. That's why I didn't name the singer's name. அது கேட்டேன்னா ப்ரோ நான் பாடினது உங்களால் கேட்க முடியாது. So emotional dissonance is you have an emotion inside, but society or our own cobwebs or conditions outside, which I presume demands that I don't show what I have. So there is so much of conflict in that emotional energy. No? So these are the three important aspects of our life as it is. For it to be a nice lyric, we need to make decisions which enhance the direction, stability, and the quantum of my time, energy, attention, and its interplay, you see. And that is the reason why an intellect does the job of questioning, asking, will this help me in these? You know, whether you ask the right question or not is secondary. The fact that you're pausing to question, you have taken a big step towards intelligence. Many times we make a choice, but we don't register the choice. Then what happens? I feel helpless, na? I start saying things like, I was forced to do that. I have no other option. What choice do I have? You see, the moment we start believing that I have no choice, na, over time my influence shrinks. Over time I stop thinking properly. Over time I start blaming. Instead of looking at the decision making within, I start looking at outside for the decision making. And then I'm no longer a complete intelligent human. I have become what is called as a helpless person. And it is not a very good road to go. Most of the mental illness, I believe, is fed apart from... there are some issues with some people having less chemicals in their head and all that. Apart from physiological cases, which are exceptions, most of the mind-induced illness comes from somewhere somebody felt helpless. Somebody felt I had no choice. Somebody felt, what can I do in this? I'm forced to do all this. And most of us are not in that spectrum of really sick and all that. But if we vote for such voices in the mind, which is what is called thoughts, what we talk to ourselves, self-talk is thought only, na? If we tell ourselves, I have no other choice, I am forced to, and I am helpless, etc., and start believing in it, we are going to completely dismantle intellect. And I'm going to say, what is the point? Anyway, I don't have a choice, you see. And that is not what our spiritual tradition, that is not what our social tradition, anywhere in the world, is ever prescribing us to do. So the first important thing for us to have is, with these three values of time, energy, and attention, we need to certainly define some purpose for ourselves. You see, corporates learned from individuals who are very spiritually advanced. And now we are getting the lessons back from corporate people. You see, corporates earlier was focused on money. How do I bring my top line, bottom line, shareholder value, and all that? Then they realized it's not a sustainable model. So they started looking at, how do I define a purpose for this organization I have? What are the values which drive my organization? That's how they grew up. Na? And one of the top sustained successful companies in the world all have a very strong sense of purpose. And without purpose, any activity, any decision would not have that vitality, that energy. and it won't have that accountability. It won't have the sustainability. So what is true for corporates is true for us. It's paradoxical because they took what was true for us and made it as a corporate principle. Now, generally, it is having more mileage than us. So I'm just trying to use that example. So for long-term success, the clear research says that if there is a purpose and a value and people live purpose and value properly, then the long-term success of that organization is assured, is what we, apart from all these sudden changes, etc. And if the purpose is not very strong, even the most brainy people, even the most intelligent people can completely create a big problem for the corporate. You see, there used to be an energy company. You all know what happened to it, creating a big economic downfall, right? It was all because it didn't have a clear sense of a proper purpose apart from make more money, you see. And so when we make decisions, first thing is let us make choices deliberately. Once I am clear, I made the choice, given the circumstances, of course, I would want the world. But if it's not available, doesn't matter. Given the circumstances, I still have to own up to, I have made this choice, let me do it. Now you may question me, but etc. Look here, I am trying to show you a way out of misery. If you want to stick to the misery, be my guest, you see. So here I am showing you a path shown by my master so that we can choose sanity, intelligence, happiness over misery. And this way of looking at life can help us to be more intelligent, more happier, and more grounded. And the path is very simple. Own up to the choices I make. Before that, I need to be clear that I made the choice. You see, I made the choice. For example, let me give an example. Suppose about four years back, or maybe 40 years back, doesn't matter. Somebody in India didn't have a job, right? And then a company offered a job with a 10% pay cut, right? Now the person can think two ways. I have no job. I have no other choice. I will sign up to this. Will you be happy working there? Now, are you working for happiness or you want happiness to work for you? You see, here the final end is happiness. That's why we do all that now. So if you see the way in which we are talking right now, there is a good chance for us to get to that state of happiness, you see. So once I make the choice, the two things I said, 40 years back, I'm jobless. Somebody gives me the 10% pay cut. I can either think, what choice do I have? So I signed it. Or given the state that I am not having a job, I now have a job which has a 10% pay cut. So I choose to take the job because I need that money to sustain me, my family, or whatever. Now you see, I signed the same dotted line with my signature. But the way I approach these two are totally different. This leads to misery. This leads to a chance of a higher success because I am looking at it as an opportunity. I am looking at it as a deliberate choice. So I am going to be pleasantly working in that company. But the same dotted line I have signed here. But now I am telling myself I had no other choice. You had a choice not to sign. But you signed because you needed that job at that given time. Yes, I would want 30%, which is a normal and a justifiable pay increase when I go to the next job. No doubt about it. But given the circumstances, that's what I meant when I use conditions of life. Given the circumstances, I can either look at it as I am helpless or I made a choice. When somebody comes and said, "Arey, yaar, Ram, 10% kam," I said, it is better than zero, 90% jada hai na. You see, this is far bigger than zero. Na? So when I make the decisions, manipulative, destructive world has lesser influence on me, bad influence. Anybody who disempowers me is, can I use the word evil? Okay. Wrong word, but lack of better. You can replace it. Anybody who empowers me, enthuses me, gives me enthusiasm is divine. The word enthusiasm means divine. It is from a Greek word called entheos. Theos, not God. That's why studying God religion is called theology. When God is within you, what happens is enthusiasm. You see? And when you are enthusiastic, it is really divine. Remember, society may not be wittingly or unwittingly. In Tamil, we have a proverb, Yam Petra Inbam Peruga Ivayagam. The joy which I have, let me spread to the world. Reverse is also true now. When most of the people around are miserable, let my misery spread around. You see? So even if I am happy, some more 90%, at least 10% gone, at least I have a job. They will come and say, Are you deserve far more. Okay, will you give me a job? No, then keep quiet now. Think like that. It is his perspective. Be empathetic to that person. Don't get influenced. You see? Once you choose with the thought, then we won't be influenced. We understand why we are doing things. And we won't just do. The mind becomes very influenced. You see that, right? The mind becomes very influenced by what happens around. It's a buddhi which needs to hold it and say, he is doing, why should you do? If that chap is buying something, why should you also buy? Do you need it? Would it help you in your time, energy, or attention? No. Do window shopping. Or do the saleswoman shopping. Go there and say, fantastic cars. Oh, super car. I don't need it. So I'm happy. You have it, very good. You see. That is what happens if we know that I need to make my choices. And I wouldn't allow the mind without proper scrutiny to make the choice on important things, at least, not on automated things, obviously. So when I own up my, this is what I found out, it's not from any book, okay? This is what I found out. And I have a good example also for you. When I am clear that I made the choice, I'm also empowered to face the consequences of my choice. I won't blame, because for me, the world is within me. The control is within me, not outside of me. I lose my humanity if I think the control is outside. And that's what is called blaming. Given any circumstances, I made the choice. So I own up to the choice. So the consequence of the choice, I am accountable. That's what is humanness now. To be responsible and accountable. That's why karma sticks only with humans, not for goats and cows. Neither do they make a choice, like this. It's not, you all know that Greek paradox. Na? If there is a donkey and you have two haystacks, two sides of the donkey, equidistant, it seems the donkey would not know where to go because both are equal distance. So looking at these two, it will die of starvation. No, hypothetical thought experiment, you see. And it is not true for our humans, right? So there is a capability for us to make decisions. And there is an extra capability for us to think, reflect, understand, and then make a choice. And we all, given the circumstances, always have a choice. Not the happy choices we have. If you agree with me, then you are with me to go in a happy path. If you fight with me, I can't help you, you see. At least see it. When you are clear, I made the choice given the circumstances. When there is a consequence, I intellect immediately said, yes, I made the choice. What went wrong? Okay, let me see if I can make a better choice tomorrow. Only intellect can speak like that. If the mind is left to its own games, the mind will say, I told you, da problem. You see? But the intellect would say, I made a choice, yes. How do I contain it? How do I make a better choice? And it will start thinking. There is another problem which needs addressing. You see? That's how the intellect will think. So first thing is, we have a choice. Yes, we do. Says who? Not me. Even Upanishad says that. I will tell you that also. We have a choice. And the choice better be driven by a strong purpose. If it is driven by a strong purpose and values, you are ready to face the small ups and downs when the consequences pan out. You see, that's the beauty of making the choice. If you want a simple metaphor for that. Suppose spouse A cooks, and spouse B eats. When the salt comes here, the pepper you could have added. there'll be lot of areas of improvement when A cooks and B eats. If A cooks and A eats, chup chup, I am clear, I cooked it. So jolly well, let me eat it, that's all. There won't be even a small murmur, see. And then I came to stay with somebody. It's a hypothetical story, didn't happen. Not in America. And he was a forced bachelor, you know, so he had to be alone and I stayed with him. And then he made some rasam, and when he started eating, chai, uppu chappillam, enna rasam saaptunda. I said, hey, you cooked it right, huh? Correct, palaka dosham. He said, force of habit, generally I'll grumble before eating. But now I cooked only, I forgot that because of force of habit, dhani pulam. I'm just saying, hypothetical, not in America. So here, this is what happens when you are accountable. Now, you are human. People will trust you if you're accountable. If you're constantly blaming, now who would want to be with us? So responsible means I made this decision because I deliberately made it. So I'm responsible. I responded to a challenge by taking a choice, by making a decision. And the decision has consequences later. When the consequences pan out, I'm able to understand, yes, I made the decision. I thought these were the assumptions. Maybe I'm wrong. Doesn't matter. I'll face it. I'll contain it. I'll go better than that. What a beautiful, lyrical, you see. And if we don't automate it, you see, the mind will automatically choose something not consciously chosen. So it will take to the next important thing is blaming. What can I do? Anybody in my position would have done like that. Are you anybody or are you somebody? You see? So the moment you get there, if the intellect has decided, it will practically say, given a choice, this is what I need to do right now. Right? And if the mind chooses, it will try to justify, rationalize, and not try to learn, rather pin the blame on something outside of you. You see what I'm saying? That's what happens, I guess. And that's the reason why you align with a purpose. Be clear about a purpose. And whenever we have to take some big decisions, ask yourself, is this in line with my purpose? Will it enhance the time for my purpose? Enhance the energy for my purpose? Enhance the attention on my purpose? Yes, do it. If no, don't do it. As I said, the society around, don't blame it. This is the age we are living in. It will be manipulative. It will be distractive. People will get more and more innovative in manipulation. That's how the marketplace is. No doubt about it. And they have researched very well human behaviors, but they have researched only a mediocre human behavior now. And we don't need to be mediocre now. We can think also for ourselves. That's the beauty of it. And the choice is there. The only choice we have is either we go to the default choosing, which is the easy choice, or you can think about what is the right choice for me to decide. Difference between easy choosing, easy na default, chosen for it. Agree, you see, whenever you go to a new program, agree is already ticked for you. One click, you see. So you just have to click this. And that's what mind does, default choosing. And not deliberately chosen, not consciously chosen. So there's a good chance of me blaming, you see. But the Buddhi says, now it's a milestone for us to make a choice. To make the choice. This is the cue. This is the trigger for you to make the choice. These are the consequences. We can quickly think about it now. Even if you have not thought about it fully, even salpamapi asya dharmasya, small little understanding of I made the choice, strengthens the intellect. And reigns in the mind. That is the beauty of this. And there is an Upanishad about a discussion between the god of death and a small boy, well-meaning boy, intelligent boy, a boy who is neither distracted nor willing to be manipulated, you see. And the teacher is trying manipulation and distraction. The boy stood his ground, wrong. The boy stuck to his principles. Stood his ground, meaning I know. So the boy stuck to his principles. You see? Sreyascha preyascha manushyam yetastau संपरीत्य विविनक्ति धीरः श्रेयो हि धीरोभिप्रेयसो वृणीते प्रेयो मंदो योगक्षेमाद् वृणीते. The vrini, vrini nale, there is a choice for us to make. It says for any manushya, shreyaha preyaha, that which is pleasing and easy choices to make, short term, some joy is coming. And prayas is purpose driven choice. For me to be liberated, the yajaman has to be liberated on the long run, but at least now some purposeful. I should have a joyful family, or I should be a responsible citizen, or I should have some purpose to improve myself, whatever purpose. He says there are two types of people, dhiraha, mandaha. Both are directly referring to our intellectual capability, buddhi. Dhi, abhingadhe buddhi lendan dhiye. So buddhi means, dhiraha means he would not jump into a decision but ask himself, is this decision of mine, is it taking me to the purpose for which I am here in the first place? He's using that. But mandaha means the charioteer slept, the driver. Horses, thank you. And suddenly when you wake up and find, where have I come to? You slept now. You were given the seat. You have to be alert. So he's saying, when you actually make the choice, we make the choice such that it aligns with some grand purpose of life. And spiritually speaking, highest purpose is realization. Keep it aside. At least some other worthwhile purposes, worth pursuing the life also we can take. And there are four things to actually use for purpose. First is taking responsibility. And understanding and inquiring, is this going to lead me to where I need to go? You see, we need to be very clear about the purpose. I love this small passage from Alice in Wonderland. All time, because Saturday, weekend, spiritually weekend, the point is, these are all day-to-day stuff, you see. So that's why I'm discussing in day-to-day language with my Purva Vasana. Here, our Alice in Wonderland, there is a nice discussion between Alice and the cat. And I think Carl Lewis has written that book. The fantastic day-to-day living principles are all hidden there. So the Alice is walking and there is a cat there, or the reverse, I don't know. I don't remember. Long time since I read it. And Alice asked the cat, because suddenly the road divided into 3-4. Alice asked the cat, "Dear cat, which road should I take?" The cat said, "It depends on a great deal on where you want to go." Alice said, "I really don't know where I want to go." And the cat smiled and said, "Any road will take you there." You see? So that's what the mind does. If you are not clear where to go, any road mind will take. And unfortunately, any road is not random. That road will be decided by somebody else. Other manipulative, distracting. If you are not using our intellectual capabilities, we will be really taken for a ride. I've seen it. You see, people can be manipulative. Society can be manipulative. Marketplace can be manipulative. Unless we are clear, you can't enjoy it. Namma Bhagavata Dharmathile, we are all rasikas. We enjoy even manipulation. Whenever I go to any stores and all, I see the pricing and all, is and whenever they say offer, I enjoy it. It's an intellectual rasas. So here, first is, if we don't allow our intellect to make the choices in line with a purpose, and a purpose which it will be nice if you are a family. Four of us sit down and think, what would be our purpose? Let us be clear about it. Instead of blindly, going, better to understand, idanava purpose. We want to go there. We want to go there. Let us not plan that way. We'll see joyful. Challenges will be joyful. And facing the challenges as a team, if it's a family or a team or a group of friends or whatever, would be joyful. It won't be stressful. If we are half asleep and we are going, it may be stressful. But if we are going in a path of purpose, every challenge is a joy. In fact, we'll joke about it later na, and think, but tough it will be like that. So here, first is to understand the purpose that we have responsibility. We have ability to respond. So we will make choices. And the second thing is to use values to guide our journey. And that's what we call dharma, isn't it? The dharma, there is something called tapas. Tapas means making that small sacrifices consciously for a higher purpose, you see? Which means I need to control a little bit of my mind every now and then. And in our Indian ethos, our elders have very beautifully put that. And we follow a little bit of it, so I'm saying. Otherwise, I won't talk about it. Especially today, na Ekadasi, apart from divinity, let it be there. Ekadasi, you know what? It is empowering us by making us challenge ourselves. Can I be without staple food for one day in a fortnight? Can I manage? And surprisingly, I'm habituated to this. And so tomorrow, if I'm suddenly denied a meal on a normal day, now I have an association to take care of it. Instead of becoming a helpless helper. What is there? You see, that is a psychological vision. Apart from spiritual, Vishnu likes it all that weekdays. Okay. Now, look at even Ekadasi. Vratam has a fantastic strategy to bring in willpower, to show us by denying, you are becoming stronger. And it is not just people who are poor who do that. Even the most rich people in India, they do Ekadasi Upavasam once in 15 days, strengthening. The mind would say, and I strengthen it. Today, nothing doing, you see? And so, I'm empowering the intellect and I'm doing it regularly as a routine. It becomes my culture. And tomorrow when I have to adapt, whether it is the top 5 companies or 10 companies, I'm going to be successful because I have the embedded software for me to adapt, to not blame, to be tough, you see? And not worry about consequence. If I had never tried fasting, then my shadow of fear would always be in me. What if tomorrow I don't get a meal, you see? But if I have already used to it, you see, simple. That is the beauty of that Indian culture, especially our Hindu culture, where spirituality, psychology, physical wellness, all integrated into one thing called religion, dharma. And that is the beauty in excellence, tapas. Now I'm getting a little more confidence. If I have decided not to eat, I have not eaten. Not once, twice. For 10 years I have done it. You feel confident. You get the buddhir balam that I understand. Yes, if I make a decision, I can stick to that. Why? I can draw to my own experience. Not overconfidence, not ego. Plain facts. When I decide I won't take rice on Ekadasi, I'm able to stick by it. Come what may. So I am empowered. You see? This is how excellence is built, because excellence comes from Atma Gunam, Adan Dharma. And to put a Western twist to it, this is what Aristotle called as virtues. You develop virtues of courage, virtues of taking tough decisions and be ready to face the consequence, virtue of truth, etc. Adan Atma Gunam, Dharma. And that's very important for the buddhi to be strengthened. That's why we need Dharma. When people say, what is the use of all these dharma? It strengthens your buddhi. Forget the Krishna Kripa, adalla, apurum patukla. But now your buddhi has to be strengthened to live in a manipulative and a destructive society. To strengthen the buddhi, develop these virtues, tapas, and compassion. And if we don't choose for compassion, you know what is the overcoming emotion which will decide the decision making? In my little experience, it is guilt. And after coming to our satsang, I learned one thing. Based on the empowerment by our master, I shall do nothing out of guilt. You see, I made a mistake. Like Vivekananda Swami said, spit on it, tramp on it, keep going, learn from it. If I do something out of selflessness or something not for myself and others, let it be out of compassion, not guilt, you see. And guilt is not a wrong emotion. Guilt is not a misplaced emotion. Guilt at times actually helps you. But this is my way of looking at it, where I want to do it out of compassion. Somebody needs it, I do it. And not feel guilty that, don't eat it. You see, why should I feel guilty? I'll simplify my diet and give more to people who are hungry. So I will let only compassion drive it rather than making it in from a position of guilt where I'm not happy and then I do it out of that not happiness and unease. Why? Let me do it out of compassion, out of understanding. So compassion, daya, enhances excellence. And then purity, being physically pure, being clear, man, purity, if you ask me. Purity means clear. I'm clear. I made the choice and I will stick by it. Purity. That's straightforwardness. Arjava, you see. And then sticking on to this because it empowers me, not for any other reason. That's the beauty of our dharma. The dharma says, why don't you embrace it for its own sake? You see, even the second sloka of Bhagavatam is very interestingly put, if you have noticed. Dharma pra ujjita kaitavaha. Anything apart from dharma is negated and pushed out. Abhridhar ke davara, the purpose of dharma is this in Gatalanga. Which means if I embrace values because I see it is grand and I embrace it, nobody can touch me in my excellence. You get what I'm saying? I am not embracing values for some reward or fear of punishment. I understand these values enrich me as a person. These are grand things to have. How many times you go to a shop and you find a largo t-shirt, then you know, t-shirt is $2. But then you have this branded t-shirts, same made in Vietnam, made in India, then, and you have that for $40. But you buy it, the grand t-shirt. You see? So human tendency is to always go for something which is grand. I will tell you the grandest thing. The grandest thing to embrace and clothe ourselves with, sadhu, sadhu bhushanam, which we'll see tomorrow morning. The grandest things are the virtues. It's grand, so embrace. Buddha Yudhishthira spoke. In Mahabharata, Swami Vivekananda, he's showing this. When they were all walking in the foothills of Himalayas, they were thrown out of the kingdom, fairly or unjustly or whatever it is, they're out of kingdom. People who were born to rule, is now going around, you see, in a forest, not knowing where will they get the next meal. In spite of all that, our Yudhishthira is very cheerful. And he is talking about dharma. Dharma, dharma. Draupadi, it seems, generally is a very, very, she is a divine lady. In spite of that, once she called him aside and said, you keep saying dharma, dharma. We are in the middle of the street. How are you still embracing dharma? You know what Dharmaputra said? He said, Draupadi, look at the snow-capped mountains, giant, huge, unmoving, yet giving so much beauty. Don't you think that we all love it? Don't you love this? She says, yes, yes, I love him. Who wouldn't not? Yes. See this wonderful Ganga Mata, gushing, lovely sound, pranamamari satam puttunu porudhu, with all the waters. Won't you love Ganga Mata? Yes, I love Ganga Mata. Do you know why you love Himalayas, Ganga Matas and this wonderful foliage all around? Because they are grand. Himalayas is grand, so I love it. Ganga Mata is grand, so I love it. These wonderful forests are grand, so I love it. Likewise, Draupadi, dharma is grand. That's why I love it. Simple. No other reason. It's a grand way to live. That's the inner excellence we say. Ibadi poyitonu chukongla, idhu excellence. This is what our Sanatana Dharma Society was. This is what our Sanatana Dharma Society is. And this is what our Sanatana Dharma Society can be. If we all understand a simple idea about how these things work inside us. You see, dharma for the sake of dharma. And that's how we get this morale high. That's how the purpose is made even more stronger. And that's why we need to keep the morale high. You see, listen to positive stories, whether it's from America or India, doesn't matter. Positive stories of people facing challenges and walking uphill and thinking if they can do, why can't I? And if you say, what about people who were born with the golden spoon? Again, go back to my first presumption. I'm giving you a chance to become cheerful. If you choose misery over cheer, no, nobody can help us. So if you want to be cheerful and get the moral, that's how you see. look at all these stories of how people fought against odds to be them. We have to pull ourselves up now. We are our own enemy. We are our own friend. Mind's friend is Buddhi. If Buddhi is keeping weight, mind is its own enemy. The actual meaning. The mind, if it is taken care by Buddhi, it's his friend. If the mind is not having a check to make sure that it is channelized, stabilized, and empowered properly by Buddhi, and then it is its own enemy, wherever they are there. That is the beauty of our intellect. It's a balanced life. This is how the same inner, I hope you have heard the first two parts also. That which is the inner organ, our Indian society calls it in four names: Buddhi, Chitta, Ahankara, and Manas. And for a normal language, mind is all these thoughts which keeps going here and there. Buddhi is the one which determines. Idam pananom. It determines. And we need the Buddhi, along with Chitta, of course, experience, etc., to direct the mind, to channelize that energy, mental energy, to stabilize that mental energy. When it's going too low, the Buddhi has to pull it up, say, this too shall pass. You see, you are not only to be blamed for this. There are external resources we couldn't control. Or it is just a small part of my life. Why should I allow it to leak into other parts of my life? Why should I carry work home? And stuff like that. You know, wrong thing to say now, but work home, na, stress home. The work stress home. This is one part over. This is no, I mean, a different role. I should not allow the role to become me. You see, I have many roles to play. Let me enjoy all the roles. That keeps my sanity and intelligence going. So that's the beauty of allowing the intellect to synchronize with the mind, so that it empowers the mind, stabilizes the mind, and also directs the mind. That energy which is the mind is directed beautifully towards the goal, towards purpose. So for that chintana, purpose, mind, what is my purpose? Why am I here? He's asked. It has to actually come from within. I will end with a small Zen story. There was once a person who wanted to know what is the purpose of life. You see? And Zen story illa romba explain panna romba chappunaidum. So I can only tell you the story, you have to figure it out. And incidentally, I'm still figuring out this story. I'm just telling you. Because generally they say, na, a good talk should end with a story. And our Zen master was there somewhere in Japan or wherever. Japan is better now. And he is sitting in an ashram in Japan, and this person had this big question: what is the purpose of life? He's a realist master, they all said. So he took tremendous efforts to come from a long on a mule. He has to travel. He came to this very, very wonderful mountain. On top of the mountain was the solitary ashram of the master. He took tremendous amount of effort to climb that mountain, and finally some flat landing, some houses around, center houses, the master's. And when he entered, he says, no, you can't see the master. He's in solitude. You can't see him. Then he said, when can I see? 1 week later. So 1 week he was sitting, eating all this little gruel which they gave. And 1 week passed. The master was ready. So he rushed in. Imagine, it was something which was bothering. He dropped everything else. Such was his resolve. So genuine seeker. So he came. The master was sitting this way. And he sat there. And one of the disciples said, our master wants you to come closer. So he came and sat here. The right hand, yeah. He came and sat here. And then he sat here, sitting here. The master looked at him and then they nudged. Master, what is the purpose of life? Abdina. Then the master raised his left hand. Abdina. Big slap. Sound. Pranava Nadam. Then he tumbled 4 steps. Then he said, interview over. Get out. Allah, he was broken. 5 months he took the journey. 7 days he sat waiting for the master. Nobody said he's a slapping master. And then I finally had this last supper before going back. at that point of time, he was very, very desolate, inconsolable. Then the person who made him sit close, he came and said, how are you doing? Did you get the interview well? He said, you were also there. I asked a question. The master didn't answer. Then that Shishya said, my master doesn't answer, but he responds to your question. You see, what did he do? Tell me exactly. Then that first said, he raised his left hand, he sat a little aside. Ah, now I know. Oh, he slapped you, right? Yes. What was the response? I don't understand. He gave a lovely answer. My master always used to tell us, never trade a good question for an answer.